Well, as the last part of the senior competition comes to close, I have the pleasure of introducing Daniel Vanderhoot to come up to speak. He is actually just from down the road in Waterdown, Ontario, where his family has a cucumber farm. And according to him, apparently public speaking is actually one of his favorite pastimes, so this could be really fantastic to listen to. We might even get a little clinic here if we're lucky. He's a first-year student at Redeemer University, taking honors in business and political science, so he's very involved, enjoys politics, and also comes from a farming background. So let's give it up to Daniel and his talk on how to explain GMO to a non-farmer.
Killer tomatoes, Terminator seeds, and Frankenfoods. Are we doomed to regret our genetic engineering escapades? Or are genetically modified organisms the key to a bountiful Canadian agricultural sector? Ladies, gentlemen, fellow speakers, and honorable judges, since the beginning of agriculture, innovative farmers have developed new varieties of edible plants. The most recent way of accomplishing this task is through genetically modified organisms, or GMOs for short. Today, let's take a closer look at what GMOs are, the risks and benefits of GMOs, and how consumers should respond. For most of history, the only method of creating new varieties of edible plants has been selective breeding, which takes one of two forms, isolation or hybridization. Isolation involves breeding plants only if they exhibit the same desirable traits. Repeatedly inbreeding ensures these traits will be passed on to the following generations. The second method, hybridization, involves breeding multiple plants with dissimilar but desirable traits to form a hybrid with a combination of these characteristics. Recurrently isolating and hybridizing traits over an extensive period of time eventually results in plants that are so different from one another, it's hard to imagine they had the same origin. A fascinating example is the common wild mustard, which was bred into broccoli, Brussels sprouts, cabbage, cauliflower, and kale. Why anyone would want to turn mustard into kale, I have no idea, but they did it through selective breeding. In 1974, the first genetically modified organism was created. Plants and animals are genetically engineered by transferring specific segments of DNA from one organism into another. Genetic engineering allows for quicker, more predictable, and specific results. Instead of hoping for a good mutation to randomly appear, genetic engineering identifies a problem like a virus, disease, or nutrient shortage, and finds a gene that can be spliced in to solve that problem. The benefits of genetically engineered crops are vast. Almost all the genetically engineered crops in Canada are either insect resistant or herbicide tolerant. If a plant is insect resistant, pest damage to the crop diminishes and pesticide use is decreased. GMOs are used to fight plant viruses. Papaya ring spot virus was killing papaya plants in Hawaii. By introducing some of the virus's DNA into the papaya plant's DNA, the virus has been effectively stopped. GMOs can also increase the nutritional content of food. Golden rice is a GMO variety designed to fight vitamin A deficiency in parts of Asia and Africa. Vitamin A deficiency kills and blinds millions of people every year in developing countries. In these areas, rice is one of the few crops that can be grown cheaply and easily. By genetically modifying simple white rice to produce extra vitamin A, 60% of the daily recommended vitamin A intake is supplied in just 100 to 150 grams of rice. This implementation of GMOs saves lives. Unaware of the benefits of genetically modified food, worried consumers believe that GMOs could increase or aggravate allergies or other health concerns. As with almost any new technology, potential risks exist and need to be investigated with care. A group of European researchers collected and analyzed the scientific literature on the topic of GMOs from a period of 10 years. They concluded The scientific research conducted so far has not detected any significant hazards directly connected with the use of genetically engineered crops. However, the debate is still intense. While it is possible for an adverse GMO to be created, diligent testing is conducted to avoid any negative consequences. This diligent testing, combined with genetically modified organisms' track record, proves that GMOs are far too valuable to abandon. A former anti-GMO activist and world-renowned environmentalist, Mark Linus, said, "As a scientist, you must have data to back up what you're saying." And I realized I wasn't holding myself to the same scientific standards on GMOs as I applied to my research on climate change. Linus realized that the anti-GMO arguments lacked supporting evidence. One of the primary GMO crops is grain corn, which farmers use to feed their livestock. If GMO crops were harmful, the cattle eating this corn daily should be showing adverse side effects, yet no symptoms arise. We should not be avoiding the purchase of GMO products under the pretext of eating healthy. In many cases, GMO products increase nutritional value, decrease pesticide use, and boost crop yields. By purchasing genetically modified products, we support the development of this technology and new varieties. By supporting GMO research now, we are growing a better agricultural future. Controlling the characteristics of plants has been done for thousands of years. Genetic engineering is a new and more precise way of achieving similar goals. Currently, no verified scientific research currently proves that GMOs are harmful, and the benefits are outstanding. As we face the unforeseen challenges of the future, the benefits of genetic modification may be the key to a bountiful Canadian agricultural sector. Let's make informed decisions about the food we eat today and look forward to the favorable future that GMOs promise.